respond to you.
Okay, that's my cue to put on my veg hat and to welcome you all to our February meeting on the cusp of President's Day weekend for the Americans in the audience. I actually had to look up before I said that whether President's Day was canceled because everything else is and has a new name, but it is, as far as I know, it is still President's Day. So we have a pretty exciting program for you today, and I'm just going to share my screen here. If I can share screen. And so we've got two guests. We write a lot. And if you look at our newsletter, and I'll show you a slide in a moment about mergers, acquisitions, consolidation, and the rapid pace of change in the virtual events industry. And we didn't even know this when we started planning it, but both of our guests today have recently done some big acquisitions and consolidations of their own, making them better and stronger than before. But before I get to them, you'll hear from Lawrence Coburn, who is a friend of Veg and has been with Twine since it was in beta, I think. He's got some big announcements, as does Andrew Nash, who's going to take us on a tour of what we're calling the pragmatic web, because it is highly doable and accessible for everybody. The great consolidation. This was just my list from this week. You've probably read, I think, the biggest news and the news in our newsletter this morning that got the most hits was Hopin's reduction in staff. It's really a right-sizing move, I believe, that when you acquire things, that's part of what happens. We know that Eventry and Meeting Play have merged. We'll talk about Twine in a minute. Zuttle raised a ton of money. Zoom acquired a company to help them. Spatial raised a bunch of money this week. Cvent gets listed on NASDAQ. The list goes on and on. But the point is that there is a lot of movement in this space. And if you read the news this morning, a company in Hong Kong called EventX got a ton of money. So virtual events are strong, healthy, and here to stay in the sizes and shapes that we keep discussing here week after week. And just to remind you where we were, if you attended our town hall meeting about 2 weeks ago, we asked you, had you been to an event in 2022? And the majority said no. You're a little self-selecting, but the majority of you said no. And the majority of you didn't expect live events to be back full swing later in 2022, and for you, probably not high on your list of attendance. So do a check-in and see where you are today versus 2 weeks ago. That's how fluid this market is, and see what those numbers mean to you. And really, I'm gonna jump to our last slide for a minute, because I want to just do a couple of housekeeping so that we don't run out of time. The newsletter is available. This morning's came out. It's all about the crypto bowl, and risk seems to be the new gold. And so definitely take a read, sign up for the newsletter. This week, we start rolling out our toy fair programming, where the toy industry had to cancel their live event at the Javits, and we created an entire series of programs for them on what toy companies and toy IP should be thinking and doing in the metaverse. It's really fun. The guests are great. I'll be rolling them out on LinkedIn as they come live, or you can go to toyassociation.org and you can see the schedule. We'll also be at Cosmoprof in April, and we are looking for beauty companies who are on the cutting edge of the metaverse in particular, but any technology. And we are setting up an innovation area to show that L'Oreal makeup you buy for your avatar may actually be more expensive than the L'Oreal makeup you buy for yourself. And finally, want you to mark your calendars for for March 31st. Stas Zaslavsky, and we're doing this meeting early, so take note, it's at noon because he's in Israel, has created an escape room for you. And we are all going to go into the metaverse and we are all going to try and escape. It's going to be a lot of fun and it will give you a whole new way to interact and see yet another verse. And then coming up, and I wanted to tell you this because I want you to be thinking about it. We are doing a big event. We'll have the date shortly on creating sustainable events, whether they're virtual, which actually chews up real electricity and power, or whether they're in the real world. And if you have anything to say about that, reach out to us and let us know. We have some exciting speakers on tap, but we want to hear more voices. We'll also have one coming up on selling sponsorships. And again, if you have unique ideas on how to retrain sales staff to sell digital bits and bytes instead of a booth or a dinner, really want to hear that. Well, also, we have one coming up that I'm really excited about. We're figuring out the date, and that's collecting data from digital events. If you can touch anything and it is recorded and your engagement is recorded, what do you want to touch? What do people really want to know about who's attending their virtual events and why? We'll have another one coming up about what the press wants. If you heard Jennifer Jolly the other day talking about CES, she didn't go there in person. She went there virtually and she got more work done. She actually spoke to 83 vendors and did like 3 television shows and never left the house. So we'll talk to the press on that night. And finally, watch for our next program, which will be probably in May when he's a little lighter on school. Our 12-year-old friend from England who just made $1 million selling weird whales is going to teach us how to create generative NFTs. And he's actually working on a big project with Barclays Bank and Oxford to teach kids how to create NFTs to earn money to go to college. So that's what's on the roster. And with that, I want to turn the meeting over to our first guest, and that's Lawrence and Helena Merck, who may not be a familiar face, but Lawrence can introduce Helena and tell you about their very exciting week. They had their own Super Bowl this week, and they'll take you through what they're doing on Zoom, which I think will make all your lives easier. So Lawrence, take it away.
Yeah, thanks, Robin. We need to update that photo of me. But thanks a lot for having me.
Wait, no top knot. Oh my God.
Yeah, heavy family pressure to kind of move on past the pandemic. So here we are. So thank you very much for having Helena and I on today. I think many of you folks have seen Twine before, and you know, just to refresh, it's a way to recreate those serendipitous conversations that used to happen in the lobby, the hallway, the elevator, the bar at your virtual event. And so for a year now, we've been running these things on the web, so via a web app. So the exciting news that we're going to share with you today is last week, Twine teamed up with a company called Glimpse, and we have the founder of Glimpse on the line today, Helena. And so Helena's founding story is super interesting. So I want to turn it over to her. And Helena, maybe you can start when you were an undergrad at Duke and kind of like what led you to start Glimpse.
Yeah, I would love to. Super excited to be here. Thanks, Lawrence. So we started about 2.5 years ago, and it was on Duke's campus. And it's funny because I'm actually back at Duke now talking to some students today. But we started because we really wanted to help people connect, people that maybe weren't stepping outside of their existing kind of circles of friends and weren't having the types of conversations they were looking for. We started iterating with that and like built out very opinionated experiences, making people meet in a certain location, having them go through a certain set of questions, and then do that over and over again with more strangers on campus. We then applied to Y Combinator. We got in and moved out to San Francisco, and that was in winter 2020, so about 2 years ago. And that was right before the entire world went online. So until that point, we were doing everything kind of in person. We're really focused on how do we get people to, you know, expand their horizons and like have like mind-blowing conversations from everything from terraforming Mars to like psychedelics or anything. Turns out in-person platforms didn't do so well when the world went online. And we decided to do a hard pivot and go into video, and that ended up working out really, really well. So a lot of the problems we were having was, you know, people not wanting to meet strangers, there being a lot of barriers to entry to meeting up with someone in person and all these other things. And when we went online, people could meet so many more people so much faster, and they could meet people who weren't geographically limited to them around them. So we ended up building something that's pretty similar to what Twine's web app is now, where we would match people kind of back to back with other people based on kind of a matchmaking graph in the background. And that the first kind of place we launched that was with student groups through like large groups on Facebook, where people were all complaining about being sent home from college. And we kind of helped them find a way to connect with each other right as the pandemic was starting. And that, you know, brought us through the rest of 2020 and a lot of 2021, when we started actively figuring out how do we bring this into places where people are currently at. And Zoom ended up being kind of the best partner to be working with. So we've been working with Zoom apps for the last 7 months now. And then when I got to know Lawrence, we realized like, wow, not only is there like insane alignment with, you know, why we're building any of this in terms of bringing people together, but also in the products and how we are thinking about, you know, bringing this to the masses.
So let me interject. So Helena, undergrad at Duke, building apps since middle school, recruits her TA, her computer science TA, to join as her first engineer, recruits her roommate as her head of business, starts a company, starts defeating me and Twine in deals. So we were losing deals to this company, Glimpse, founded by 20 years old, raises money from YC, raises money from Maven, who was some of the first money in Zoom, and cuts a deal to get special access to build apps on Zoom. So this is what Helen has been doing as a kind of a young 20-year-old. I'll ask the group, what were you all doing when you were 20? I was not doing this kind of stuff. So that's a great setup. So Helena, do you think we should show everybody the Twine for Zoom app that you and your team built?
Let's do it.
Okay. All right. So this is super exciting. Not too many folks have seen this outside of Twine and Glimpse. And as Helena mentioned, her and her team has been working closely with Zoom engineers and product people to get this off the ground. And so we're going to do a quick live demo here. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen. And so this is going to be a little bit of a confusing view for people, but what you should see in the sidebar is Twine for Zoom. And let me set this up for you. So Zoom is building an app store. So similar to what Apple did with iTunes, and you can download apps developed by third party developers. They have about 60 apps available to the world today. These are big companies, Asana, Dropbox, Box. But what they don't have is any apps built on Zoom breakout rooms. And so Twine for Zoom is one of the first ones of those apps. So I'm going to fire this up, and you can see it's kind of loading here. And one of the many really thoughtful things about Helena and her team is they built a couple of different modes. So as I think about event planners and creating experiences, you want to have options. It's not one size fits all. So Helena, why don't we start off with map mode and guide me through what you want me to do here. And why don't you set it up for us?
Yeah, since we have a large group, let's add 10 tables, and let's make them all have 5 seats. I think beyond 5, you can't really have too much of a constructive time in a breakout room. Cool. And now what you see, thanks for popping that out. We can see this visual view of breakout rooms, and this is directly interfacing on top of your existing Zoom client. So you notice that there's a breakout room button now, and those rooms have actually been created. If you have the app installed, you'll see exactly what Lawrence is seeing here, where you can pan over the tables and click join. We're not having you all install it right now, just because of a few different hoops of it being in beta. But once it's live, this is exactly what it looked like for you. And you won't be seeing it through Lawrence's screen share.
So Helena,
you're on the line, and you want to pop into a table?
As a meeting planner, do you have to tell everybody to download the Twine app first? Is that how it's going to work?
So there's two different modes. We'll walk through the host mode in just a second. But in this mode, it's kind of like super simple, a visual of what kind of Zoom already has in their breakout rooms. with additional limitations around how many people can be in a breakout room. So that this is like the visual map view of it. And then Lawrence, do you want to switch to the matchmaking mode and we can kind of walk exactly through what you just asked?
Sure. Okay, so why don't we move to matchmaking?
Amazing. So here, before you click next, you'll notice at the bottom, there's this host only mode. So this Robin describes if an option we have where only the host has it installed and they can use this as like, you know, a tool in their back pocket to automatically move people around in fun configurations. We support that. We also support an interface where people install it and then they can add in information. So here you can see the three different matchmaking types we support. The first is random, which is self-explanatory. The next one is A-B matching. So you can imagine like mentor, mentee, where you're strictly matching across two different groups. And then tag-based is extremely flexible. So if you wanted to do something based on interests or maybe like compound tags or something like that. So we can try out the tag one. And here you'll see some of the additional settings we built out, like the length of a match. So just like Twine and Glimpse's like original web versions, we're automatically moving people. So you don't have to ever spend time like with the Zoom interface, like clicking and dragging people or asking them to switch rooms or anything like that. That's all gone now. So here you can see Lauren set 2-minute matches, groups of four. He added a tag of a buyer and then a seller. And once you install the Twine for Zoom app, you will be able to self-select who you are, like who you're representing and who you want to talk to. And this is exactly the interface you'll see. And what you'll notice with this tag-based matching is he can specify exactly what his preferences are. And he's only going to get matched with, you know, a buyer and a seller that's also interested in who he is. And through that, it's just like cross compatibility. Sweet. So the next step we can't really demo right now because we don't have you with app installed, but he could click on start matchmaking and everybody would get launched into breakout rooms and go into matches.
Yeah, and what I love about this is the power it gives the planner. So I can press start matchmaking and everybody on the Zoom would start to zap off and you would see them disappear. And they would drop into these rooms, but they're okay. Don't worry about them. They're going to be in a breakout room over there. And then there's a countdown clock, and then you're matched with the next table. And then if I get tired as the host, I can just say stop matchmaking, and I yank everybody back. I can also message everybody across the top or just some people. And the crazy thing about this is that it's all in Zoom. Nobody has to go anywhere else. We go through Zoom's InfoSec, so it's all secure, tested by Zoom. There's no login, there's no handoff. Like at Twine, we're running these at the beginning and end of every meeting. So after our all hands meetings, we're popping into little tables. I'm like, hey, Ann, let's go talk about SEO stuff. I'll see you at a table over here. And we can just go drop into the table. So there's so many use cases and it's so easy. I'm really excited. We're gonna be pushing it out in the world for free. And so it's a very, you can tell I'm a little excited about this. And just for the record, we did not build this. Helena and her team of 22-year-olds built it.
But we really, well, we totally want to gossip. We want to know, did you meet on Twine or Glimpse?
Unfortunately, we met on Twitter.
Well, that's where everybody, right. That's where, well, soon everybody will just be meeting on Twine. And seriously, no. Seriously, going back, if you look at the events business, and I'll use Shop Talk as an example of somebody that did it really well, paired buyers and sellers, analysts and press, and it is so important, and it has been the missing link from every event to meet the people that you want to meet. But you wanted students to meet, so are your populations really different, the two of you, and do you have to bring them together?
Well, so I think Helen and team started universities, but they very quickly got pulled into companies and events like, they're working with a lot of great events that you all have probably heard of as well. And so we're going to continue to support their web product. And now the Twine for Zoom app is obviously going to be available as well. And so what happens from here is we expect Zoom to open this thing up in the next 2 weeks or something. Helena, is that fair? And so the special offer that we have for for veg folks is that if you wanted to try this out with a little bit of handholding, there's a waitlist link that Anne is going to drop into the chat that puts you on a very special early access link. And then we would have our team kind of walk you through, make sure you're comfortable using the tool and kind of turn you loose into the world to try it out. Is that-
Yeah, Lawrence, I think you told me there's something like 700 people on that list already.
That well, it's 850 now. It was 700 a couple days ago. But it's, I think Zoom breakout rooms are really powerful, but as Robin can attest, it's a little clunky. A lot of things can go wrong. I think what Helen has built is super easy to use. Okay. All right. I think we're good here. So Helen, do you have any last comments?
Nope, nothing on my end.
I'm going to mute some of these folks.
Okay, so we have people already saying there, Cynthia, we're going to give you a handhold. Yeah, everybody should go on and sign up and we'll play together. And then, you know, in about a year, I think we're going to have marriage parties, like who, you know, which companies have really, you know, come up through the ranks and created something new and different. So Helena, I know you have to run to go talk to students. Just don't tell them all to drop out, right? I feel like your mother talking.
I'm a little torn. We'll see. We'll see.
Dropping out's only for a special few. I can list them on my fingers. And actually, you're one of the women that I know. So I'm really proud of you who have succeeded in this journey. So I can't wait to see what's next. We're going to let Lawrence shut down his screens. Unless anybody have a quick question or comment.
Robin, I made you, you're the host again. So back over to you.
Okay.
So hi, this is Catherine. Hi. Simply because I've worked in the conference area and very technical environments. So say at the American Chemical Society, people come in and they have like many, many different tracks and very focused areas of presentation. I'm assuming that longer term, you'll have the ability for people to pick for an event prof to pick, say, and say, I want to match this track person with this type buyer. Okay, that's wonderful in very technical and scientific communities, because it's nice to have a buyer be able to meet a seller, but if the seller is selling something that the buyer isn't buying, poof. And that's really a remarkable thing for those conferences where the need is desperate.
And it's actually available today via self-selection, but I think the more enforced tags and groups is coming.
Great. Oh, God, you are just going to be loved when you get, well, not that you aren't, you're going to be loved when you get to that point. Thank you.
Thanks, Catherine. Okay. Now we're going to take a look at what we're calling, and we're actually giving Andrew, goodbye, Helena, good to see you. We're gonna give Andrew the credit for coining this term, at least the first I'd heard of it. The first conversation I had with Andrew was a discussion about the pragmatic metaverse. And the metaverse, as we know, is a very big idea filled with all sorts of lofty, interoperable, headset-laden, cumbersome things right now. And Andrew and his company Room has figured out a way to provide the experience of the metaverse, including the interoperability, in a way that is accessible to everybody, regardless of what hardware they have. And as the user, you can pick the parts that you want to use and not. It's incredibly full-featured. So what might have taken you 40 tools to create an event can take you just one room. And so Andrew, I'm gonna bring you up on our screen. And let's start with who you are and tell us a little bit about how you got to work, how you got to Room and what you're doing.
Well, thank you, Robin. Andrew Nash, I'm actually the CEO of the Americas for Room. I'm not the founder of Room. I have a wonderful founder, Hans Elsner, a company in Germany. And the background of the company was it really came together from a group of individuals who are very passionate around gaming and 3D and saw some applicability for the entire environment once the pandemic blew through. It's just exceptionally well placed, because unlike a lot of folks who was coming from an event perspective and saying, how do I replicate our event? We have a very strong point of view, which is you need to be very inclusive. You need to get everybody involved. All the tools are available today. They don't need to be invented. But it's probably not going to be everybody putting on, a headset, right? So we essentially put, I got involved because I've been doing tech for a lot of years and met the founder and said, this is an insanely exciting opportunity. And we'll show you some of the technology that we've done today. But we had a couple of very strong beliefs: was needed to be accessible, inclusive. And in fact, our goal is kind of really an interesting one. And this is a nod to those of you who know Canva out of Australia. And I love the team, Melanie and others out of Australia, who put together Canva because they saw an opportunity to create digital for every person. We have the same mission. We want to create 3D, democratize the metaverse, and make it really easy to assemble digital experiences, however you want to create and deliver digital experiences.
And so I talked a little bit about the Pragmatic Web, but I stole it from you. So why don't you, just tell us your vision, 2D, 3D, AR, tell us, lay out the vision, and then take us on your tour.
Well, the pragmatic actually came about from a home conversation, because I had a son who built an esports organization and was Twitch streaming in the basement while he was at college. And my wife kept saying, what is he doing? I said, he's participating in the most exciting transformation of the sports industry you have ever seen. And for those who know it, he put together, him and his clan, put together the number one Apex Legends and one other team. I won't give him too much kudos. And they were Asia Pacific champions. And he did that from his college dorm in North Carolina.
North Carolina seems to be a really hot spot for creation.
It's the place. So what became pragmatic was I then literally put a list of about 500 things just to convince my wife, these are the things that will be done in the metaverse. And I'm going to run you through them today. Just a small snippet of what will happen. And it's not just turbocharging Zoom and doing a few other things. It's actually, we will live and interoperate. And I'm broadcasting to you from my little mini metaverse studio.
So I'm going to let Andrew take it away, but everybody in the audience, feel free to post your questions in the chat room and we will take them as they come. This is a big undertaking and a big project. So, okay, Andrew, you're on.
Okay, thank you. All right, so first thing I'm going to do is, and I apologize for everybody being back to the non-metaverse, and I'm going to do a little bit of death by PowerPoint, but I'm going to do this very deliberately just to explain how big the concept is of how we decided to architect and deliver this. So just kicking through a little, our metaverse journey is really centered around what I believe there are two types of digital heroes that are about to be a crazy new industry. I've had the benefit of nearly 40 years in the tech industry, and I've been through all sorts of fun things like the ERP curve in the 90s and the whole e-commerce thing. And all of a sudden, the next 10 years is going to be about digital experience producers. If you think a DevOps person was hot, wait till you see what a digital experience producer is going to be. The other new one is actually going to be a digital community manager. Okay. And community is just, and this is the point I'm going to make here. Community and audience is just as critical as metaverse. To quote a very, very friend and colleague, done some amazing things, Athena Demos from Big Rock Creative, you need a digital greeter in your metaverse. You don't just have people turn out and figure out what to do next. So a greeter, a community manager, a curator is just going to be as critical as a digital experience producer. And the interesting thing is, you don't know who the digital event producers are going to be. It could be me, it could be my persona, it could be my automated bot personas. Who knows? But it's going to be fun. So what we want to do is help people easily create, manage, and produce 3D digital experiences. We believe in an inclusive world. No technology is going to be correct. We all need to work together. We all need to have fun. And we're on the front end of something that's actually very, very cool. So we believe in a couple of things very strongly. Number one, we believe, you see this? This is the most prevalent device. I can guarantee every single one of you has your phone within 4 feet of you. Am I correct? Right, we'll have a little test later and you'll find out, right? So that is the most prevalent device. If I want to reach a million people, I can reach them by that because the networks and the proliferation are already there. So we believe, therefore, we need to deliver technology on that device. To do that, you need to be browser-based. So said differently, you don't start with the headset and then reverse engineer down. You start with the lowest common denominator technology-wise and build the most incredible experience you can on that. Now, by the way, we are part of the Kronos Consortium. We do believe in WebGL, GLTF. We have a few friends in that consortium, folks you might recognize, NVIDIA, Apple, a few others. So we're not betting on our own there. The other thing that we, go on, Robin. Whoops, not hearing you, Robin. You can jump in a minute, Robin. We'll save that one. The next thing is we looked at this and said, in order to create a metaverse experience, you need to combine upwards of 10, 12, 15 different tools into one seamless backbone and experience. So to that, we broke it up into what we call the space cloud, the product cloud, the event cloud, and the immersive experience cloud, which is really marker-based AR. But we feel like we didn't have enough toys, so we acquired another company, VRON, which we just acquired this week, that actually helps us with collaborative product design and development using headsets and experiences like this. So what I want to get to very quickly, because I want to have time for the demo, was one of the things I observed, because I'm a newcomer to this party. I only jumped into this party about a year ago after 36 years of technology in every other industry on the planet, frankly. And I looked at this and said, why is everybody focused on just the engagement tools in the metaverse? Avatars, live streaming, volumetric video, text chat, video chat, breakout rooms, whatever. That's great. That's an important part of the experience. But if you put all of those in a white room, what sort of experience do you have? What sort of a venue are you doing this at? So I think one of the things that we've led in this charge in the metaverse is we've been very focused on creating the digital tooling and the collaboration and connecting to the digital touch points, whatever the touch point is. But we need to think about, why do we turn up? I mean, I don't know about you. I like turning up to a restaurant that actually has some ambiance. I don't like turning up into a white restaurant with a white table and hope that they give me the best knives and forks. I'm looking for a great experience, and it's not just the food. Right. So what we felt, we need to be able to do all of these different things. We needed to create virtual hybrid events, booths, exhibit halls, digital twins. The dirty little secret on how we really went down this path was in the middle of 2020. There was a little group called IFA in Berlin, which is the equivalent of the CES show in Vegas each year, who were desperately looking to somehow replicate their 3D exhibit halls. And we said, we can do that. And we launched one of the single largest virtual events in the world in September of 2020 with over 200,000 attendees, 80,000 of whom were from China, segmented off into their own section. And we also have built out the entire 3D exhibit halls. And I will demo and show you some of the stuff that we created. The more important piece there was the actual trade exhibit vendors built their own experiences inside of our metaverse. We didn't do it for them, which was really cool. But my point is, the big value in the metaverse, which is really the next turbocharge and push, is actually building really cool and creative spaces that you can do things in. And then you can leverage a very open, interoperable metaverse set of tooling. I'd love to take the Twine tooling and the Glimpse tooling and put it into our platform. It's a perfect complement. There are hundreds of other tools that will actually all be able to work together and play nice. We don't believe a single technology is going to win. We believe very strongly in the whole Web3 open interoperable metaverse. Now, the way to do this, and I'm going to give you the quick run through, then I'm going to give you the moving pixels. You first of all got to put together a space. Start with a template or a blank canvas. We have hundreds of templates. You can just put them together or create one yourself. If you've already created something in Unity that you love, download it. We'll tweak it. We'll push it up, and then we'll create that. We did that with someone last week in less than 2 hours. Took the Unity experience, took it down, converted it, and then we put it up and we had it inside of our platform. Now, the beauty of our platform, as you'll see in a moment, entirely browser-based. So Next thing is, we don't believe in a single avatar system, and we do believe in interoperability. NFTs and avatars will live between multiple worlds. On the left-hand side, can we integrate Ready Player Me? Yep, us and about 1,000 other people have done that already. Do you want toons? Do you want abstract avatars? Do you want robotic avatars? Do you want photorealistic? And if Charlie Fink is watching today, this is Charlie Fink's photorealistic avatar that we used at the Augmented World Expo last year. We believe this is the example of where we're futuring. The next thing is to put real life objects and products into the metaverse. The next thing you want to do is even do things like product configurations and explainer videos and explainer objects inside of the presentation. If you don't know how to do this, don't worry about having a CAD system and using Autodesk and bringing in 3D models. Pick up this little device that's 4 feet away from you. Go and take a photograph of the object, and we'll put it into a very simple pipeline and create the 3D asset that you can then go and place in your metaverse, miniverse, multiverse, or omniverse, or what I call soon to be the clutterverse. But you know, whatever, however you'd like to do that. So that's an important piece. The next thing is, we actually have built an event cloud. Not that we're trying to replace an attendee management system. We're trying to create new events. The one I've got on the left there, on top left, Deutsche Telekom decided not to attend Mobile World Congress last year and built a 5,000 person event that was delivered entirely inside of a 3D experience. And I'll show you some of that. That platform has now been reused multiple times, and this is one of the key pieces of our platform. You assemble digital assets, you reuse them, and you create hundreds of experiences. It's not about a single experience. And we believe that the world is going to always on in terms of events and experience. And that is going to be a big change. It's going to take some time because people have got to get used to it, but it's available now. The next thing is, we can do any immersive marker-based AR. We've actually even included Matterport scans and experiences and put virtual objects inside of those Matterport scans and experiences as well. Finally, we're tying it all together in what we call, for our customers, the new land, which is our own omniverse. And we will have all of our metaverses connected in that, and we will connect a third party and other metaverses as well. So we believe that way. So rather than me talking a lot, I'm going to show you this stuff now. But I wanted to give you the background and context as to how we thought about this and how we got there. So the very first one we're going to do, hold on to your headsets. This is going to be a little bit of fun. So we are now, and I'm going to say to you, we are now in a browser-based experience. And this is a really important piece of this, because what we are now in, I'm now in a world. And if you listen to what happens. Okay, what we've created here is an entire 3D world. We will be launching this later this year. We have customers who will be having EDM dance parties and raves inside of this platform. Now, the reason I raise and start here, this is template-based, and we're using exactly the same platform that we used for Augmented World Expo last year that we represented, and we had a hall for the Augie Awards and the trophies and the presenters. The other thing that we did in this platform, you can see over here, if I browse through, you can see over here, I've got merchandise. If I want to go into merch, I can click on the merch over here and sell the merch as well in the environment. Okay, so I could keep going on about this. The fun part here, and we've got an upstairs piece here where the record label actually wants to promote. I'm not allowed to show you that because that would be a breach of my, you know, those folks are a little sensitive, but they're all good. They're great. We like them. So let me quickly run you through how do we do this stuff and how do we orchestrate it together, and how do we actually get it to fit inside of a browser? So get your phone ready. This is the audience participation part for the next part of the demo. So the way we do this, we have this wonderful little bicycle here. Looks pretty cool, pretty photorealistic. Just to show you that I'm not a magician, I'm actually going to reload the experience and show you how quickly it takes in my browser, okay? So there we go. It loaded. And by the way, zero download on our code here. It's just browser-based. It's loading entirely in the browser as we speak here, and guess what? Boom, it's done. I can now place any of those assets or experiences. I can annotate this bike, I can do whatever, and it's just a package or an object in the experience, okay? So this is the, think of this as the lowest granular piece, and it's pretty cool. And I can do close-ups, I can scan in, and if I'm really smart, once I've got this asset, I can actually put it on my website for e-commerce as well, because I've already got that done. I can put it in virtual product brochures. I can do also some other things. So now you're starting to see the front end of Pragmatic. The front end of Pragmatic is it's all about reuse and simplicity and assembling the assets. Now, because I get your phones out, I'm going to do this and have a bit of fun. I want everybody to scan that QR code and now tell me exactly how much code you had to download to your phone and how quickly it loaded. And I'm going to give you a little bit of time while you do that. But you are now being invited into my metaverse, and you are now downloading and playing with one of my digital products, which could equally have been an NFT. It could have been an avatar. It could be something else as well. So have a bit of fun with that. And I'm so confident that could happen because I've tested this hundreds of times. It's pretty cool. Now, we also, for those of you who are Pokemon nuts, have an AR-based scenario. So it's similar to placing your Pokemon on a rock or a tree. You could take this object and go place it on the table or your desktop. And the most important thing, quick, lightweight, you have zero code download. And that's how you can participate very quickly. Does that make sense, everybody? Lots of thumbs up. There we go. Very good. All right, so that's the fun. Now, here's the fun part about that.
Andrew, one question that came up, some people had latency problems in the audio. Is that because we're browser and browser, which is a feat in itself?
It's going to depend on the particular, the network connection, the CDN, the whole thing. But it's generally not too bad.
Right.
You know, it's... And just for everyone's benefit, I'm doing this in my office over Wi-Fi access. So there's no tricks here like, you know, direct wire in, you know, a fiber optic from my machine to my router or anything. This is...
A terrifying number of other windows open, right?
Yeah, well, that's at least in this one. I promise I have at least 500 browsers open. That's kind of the way I live. You know, it's kind of how I roll. So that's the fun part. Now, let me take you to... This is actually for the company Pookie. That we, for those of you who know European bicycles, Pookie is a great kids bike, and I'm just going to load this experience. And this is an entire miniverse experience or a room. And this should load in less than 15 seconds and it'd be a full interactive experience. And boom, did even better than it was advertised. Now I'm actually in a room where I can look at, I'm going to have a bit of fun with this. You see, when we move around the room, doesn't it look like she's looking at you the whole time? That's a hack we learned in gaming in the late 90s. It's how you focus the camera. So we put a whole bunch of fun stuff in there, but you can see fun little environment. We've got a little, I get you seasick there. A little spoke there in the sky for a little bit of a fun feature. We can move around over here. I'm also going to take you over to, just to show you, it wasn't a parlor trick before. I'm in an experience now. I'm going to double click on a scooter. And I'm going to show you that scooter. And let's see how quick that loads. Now I'm 3D inside of 3D inside of a browser. Pretty cool, huh? Not too bad. And if we want to have a little bit of fun, go scan the AR code there as well. But we won't do that now. So now I've just created an object. I've put it in a space, which could be a showroom, a dance hall, or whatever. Here's what it actually looked like at IFA. So Roborock, think of like a Roomba or a Dyson competitor, built their entire demo room here. You can see this. And when I say built it all they did was they placed a video on the wall. And that's a URL that you cut and paste. There's nothing else you can configure. Everybody on this call can actually take a URL and they can place that on that wall. Trust me, I know you can do that, right? The next thing is we can actually take, we can on here, I can punch out to the website. If you need to go to a website or another digital experience, no problem. The more important piece is over here, I can also get in and look at, again, this is exactly the same platform. I'm just loading up the Roborock here. You can see how quick it is again. And I can have a whole bunch of fun with this. And by the way, have a look at the quality of that. All in your browser. Pretty cool, huh? Right? So that's what we built for IFA. IFA had, you know, hundreds of booths that were built and delivered this way, all as part of that digital experience. That hall is still available today. And this is the important part of our platform. If you still want to go to that hall, we can organize through Robin to get you the links. It still exists. So it's a persistent digital experience. This is truly what you're starting to get some pragmatism going. We do some other really cool things there. Now, the other one I want to talk a little about, we talked a little earlier about the telecom experience. I'm going to show you the video just a little and pick some features here just to show you. And so bear with me for a little. So that entire experience is also using our experience. If you know Deutsche Telekom or T-Mobile, everything is magenta, right? So we've just overlaid a whole lot of magenta in 3D. And you can see the avatars walking through here, but that's not really the cool piece. Check that. If I put my mouse over there, I can actually immediately have a one-to-one chat with that individual, video-wise, text-wise. I can favorite them and connect with them, and I can talk to them while they're on the platform. So some cool features there. In here, you can see, I'm going to just take you back there for 2 seconds. You can see a pretty cool hall here, right? We created this fun hall, which is fully interactive. You can interact with that, or the humans or everybody in there as well. We can have live sessions. And I'll just show you a couple of things here that was really fun. We put this in the sky above Barcelona, which is where it would normally be. If you've ever been to one of the Mobile World Congresses, it's Barcelona. And you can see that we did that in the sky above there as a nod to Barcelona. You can see below that. But here's the fun part. I can actually do any video in there and I can brand it accordingly. The agency, now here's our version of a breakout room, and we can put somebody else's breakout room or capability here. And I want you to watch this. We created our own digital experience on top of this. And if you just go and join, you immediately join the breakout room as you wander around an event and similar. Now, we can take many different underlying technologies. Before someone asks me, we can use all sorts of fun. We have native video within the platform. We can use Vimeo platforms. We can use Zoom platforms. We can use content flow platforms. We've got all sorts of other tools underneath this. We are not about telling you which tool you need to use. We want you to extend or use your existing tooling or capability, because you don't want to repurpose anything. That's an important part of our strategy. The agency for Deutsche Telekom actually constructed the majority of this using our tooling as well. So we didn't just build it all for them, or they didn't do it all themselves. It was a collaborative environment. So I can show you a couple more things here, and that's kind of the fun stuff. And then we can obviously embed video, doing green screen similar to what I'm doing here at the moment. We're adding a volumetric video and a couple of other fun things a little bit later. Now, here's the reuse angle. That entire environment is being reused in about 30 days for MWC 2022 in Barcelona. If you don't believe me, go to mwc.telecom.com and register to participate in that particular event virtually and remotely. Okay?
I thought you were going to invite us to Barcelona, Andrew.
Almost. Yeah, my favorite.
Yeah, and it's all, your point, it's all reusable from what you built for them.
That's exactly it. Yeah. Now, we have done fun stuff, and I'll show you here. This is what I would call more the 2D world that we just augment with a lobby. We did this for the National Foundation for Cancer Research, and we're building an oncology metaverse for the researchers around the world. These are some of the most, the prominent scientists globally who are working on cancer. And they are now reusing and repurposing. And to show you the live demo, if I need to log into, they're now repurposing it for a new event, which is a dialogue with leading oncologists. And these are other events that we put in there. But that's not what I wanted to show you. We actually created a fun little lobby for them. And again, watch how quickly it loads. And I'm doing this because I want you to see how quickly this all is browser-based, because I didn't want to show you there were any tricks in there. There it is. And if I want to go in here and look at someone who's the key individual, look around the lobby, come over here and play this video. I can do it here. I can push that straight in. That's now a pervasive environment that also now has an entire video wall, which has all the different events and speaking previously, fun image gallery, all sorts of other things as well. Now, I'm going to be really quick on my last 5 minutes and say, how do we do this magic? And I'm going to show you the way we do it. You see this? This is a blank room. We talked about the white blank room that I can create a space. All I do is take an object, and I'm going to show you how we do this, and I place it somewhere. I pick up a template of this booth. I place this photo of me, there you go, in the photo. And I can then put objects in there. And these are just URL links and an image. And I can then show you everything about my products and my offerings in that booth. I can put that in there. Now you say, ha, how do you do that, Andrew? Now I'm going to show you the configuration page. Now, does anybody feel like they could probably just say, I do want to turn site. I don't want to turn site. I want to put an iPad in there. I don't want to put an iPad. I want this booth. I wanted a particular color. And I can even choose which human I want to put in there and do a photorealistic bottom third, put something in there, and I can actually put your CEO or somebody else in your experience or a person in your experience. And then if you can see over here, see the funky fun stuff where the person keeps looking at you no matter where you go to? We got hundreds of little Easter eggs in there that we did that was kind of fun. Now, here's an example of where we integrated Ready Player Me into a really cool little winter experience in downtown Jena in Germany in the old GDR, if anybody's ever been over there. And I'm going to show you, this is the real experience. I select my particular avatar. I would go into this really cool experience and I'm up and running. Now this is a little slow because it's got a round trip and validate, but you know, it's not too bad. Now again, remember I'm loading an entire 3D experience for the city of Jena in Germany, and I can walk around it. So this is kind of a, I'm not going to call it a toonish digital twin, but this is kind of a digital twin example. And in this case, anybody in Jena, Germany could all hang out here in the holidays and drink and just hang out with each other. So this was kind of a fun experience and a nod to one of the cool local startups. That's fun. Pretty cool here. If we want to walk over. Pretty cool, huh? And for those of you who don't like the music, we can kill it. It's okay. So where I want to finish up with is this is really, the new metaverse is only as narrow as your imagination. You literally can create all of this. You can create all of this now. If we did this literally inside of a browser that doesn't need to be in VR, do we support VR in that mode? Absolutely, we can do that. We can have mixed mode of execution. But we built it this way because we wanted it to be very inclusive. We have had a whole bunch of fun and stuff that we've created. And if you saw our new land, and I'm going to finish there with new land. We'll have a bit of fun with that in a minute. This is our new land metaverse we've actually built. This is, you come to our new land metaverse and you have a bit of fun. And I'm going to show you that when we get out of our old experience here, give me a second. We pop out of our experience. This is our little metaverse. You see that? We have created our own beautiful metaverse. And you can go into any one of these mini verses and you can repurpose them however you want. Now, just to have a bit of a fun while I'm just closing out, we also did this for Augmented World Expo. We built and reused this and streamed the entire event through our platform. And we do have corporate implementations, and I'll show you this and then shut it down quickly because we love our friends at Vodafone, but you know, here's an example of where we just create a very simple hall where we could connect and just hang out and do presentations and training and similar. So this is the corporate training use case. So while this is loading, I wanted to show you an incredible range of digital experiences which represent this much of what we can do. So part of this is, and we can interoperate and integrate and work with anybody else's stuff. This is a pretty fun experience, right? I want to move up the front.
I'm going to ask for questions, but first, can everybody put up their hands? Because like Andrew, I've never seen anybody go through that many windows in a demo without any problem, without any glitches. It was pretty extraordinary from where I sat. Somebody wanted you to address the 3D headsets. You do support them, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. That's mine. Yes, we do. Yeah, so, but it's an important point. We're engineering for the lowest common denominator first and then coming up to the headset experience, as distinct from, if you've ever built a headset experience, and I've done many, it's hard to then reverse engineer and go down.
And you recently made some acquisitions, so you have to fit in with my theme here of acquisitions, right? You acquired some properties this week too.
Yes, yeah, we announced earlier we acquired VRON in Munich for doing, in fact, going a lot deeper into virtual reality and Unity and other environments and platforms, as well as product collaboration and other use cases, including learning as well. And we got a couple more on our sleeve. We're going to keep growing. We've grown tenfold in the past 12 months, just to give you the size of growth.
And of course, the question I ask that I know is on everybody's mind out there is like, how much is this going to cost me? And Andrew assured me that this is starts up 5,000 and up. Is that about right?
$5,000 at a very low end, up into the millions. We will announce shortly a multi-million-dollar multi-year deal. So everything in between.
Yeah, it's vast. And as we move, you know, as the events industry starts to evaluate 2D, 3D, and which way they're going to go, and this really is a schism going on right now between what events are deciding to do. You just saw a look at something that can do both. So let's hear hands for Andrew. Any questions? I have my application up to remind you again, we're going to hold March's meeting a little earlier in the day because Stas comes from Israel and we can't like make him stay up that late, but he is going to teach us how to go into his metaverse and then escape it in an escape room. And so that should be lots of fun. And again, if you missed the beginning of the meeting, these are the things we have coming up. We're looking for people who have a passionate interest about sustainable events, both in real world and in terms of energy uses in virtual. Any smarts about selling sponsorships and bits and bytes, collecting data, digital events, what the press wants, and then we're going to treat you to the sweetest young man that you've ever met, the 12-year-old NFT creator who can explain to you better than anybody how to do it. So Andrew, with that, I just want to give you another shout out to Helena, who's had to go back to school, to Lawrence from Twine, to An. Thanks again for another great meeting. Thanks to all of you. I hope you learned something and we'll be with you next month with lots of new announcements. And wait, signing out, the Veg Group is going to veg out. Bye.